get these quizzes right. If you do that, when you take a science class, how many of you are any kind of science major? You take chemistry, you take biology, you take all of that stuff. When you read, as you go through, before you declare that you own that page and put the check mark and say, that's mine, make your flashcards. Whatever came from that page that's factual, that you know you're not going to, it's not the kind of thing you just can remember because you got the concept. It's a list of things, or it's a specific value, or it's some sort of taxonomy, hierarchy, or something. Put that on a flashcard and add that to your flashcards, and put the page number and the name of the book and the class on the thing, and then that's permanent. You'll have that when you're my age. You can go back over the stuff, and you can keep your textbook information just like you had it. It'll help you when you take your MCATs and your LSATs and everything, too. Let me take a quick look.
Yeah, 25%.
Quizzes are 20%, midterm is 25%, final is 35%, term paper is 10%, and participation, which means Kurtz dollars, is 10%. In this I say potentially 10% because you don't get 10% if you don't get enough. All of those are potentially you can get that much.
How much is enough Kurtz dollars?
I don't know. Everything else I use these percentages, but when it comes to the end, if I've got an outlier who's got like 100% and the next person has like 89 or whatever, I'm not going to make that 100% the 100%. I'm going to go down to where it's not an outlier. If there's like two breakouts and then there's this huge margin to where the real people live, I'll start at the top of the cluster. Okay? The people that I'm certain are probably actually of our species, and they don't incorporate any silicon at all in their neural circuitry. I'll make that the 100. If for some reason it makes the whole thing so bad that like the class average is ridiculously low, then I'll drop down further and modify the top to make it so that it's reasonable, and I'm shooting to have the average here be somewhere about in the, like, not a B minus, maybe the top of the B minus or the bottom of the solid B, sort of. I want to see right there. I'd like to have the average come in on that. Does that make sense? As far as the Kurtz dollars go, he will count the Kurtz dollars. He'll list the number of them. And it'll just say how many you have right on the gradebook online. So you can see it, and I can see it, and he can see it. And then I'll make another category for the actual percent that you're going to get for that amount. Then I spit out an Excel sheet. I order it from highest to lowest. I eliminate down to like the ridiculous outliers and get down to where it's even just a modicum of acceptability. Then I take that many and go down to a certain amount and go, it's worth 10987654321 on that basis. And then if somebody's got zero, I can tell you straight up, they'll get zero. If they've got one Kurtz dollar, it's probably going to take more than one Kurtz dollar to add up to one of those percentage points. But I can't quite tell yet. Fair enough?
You said that we could like buy points back on quizzes and stuff from
Yeah, we'll have auctions from time to time. When you try to buy them, somebody else might have more money and try to take it away from you.
And then my other question, if we do buy quiz questions, that doesn't count towards our final attendance grade?
You mean your participation grade?
I mean, yeah.
If you use the Kurtz dollars in an auction to buy something, mm-hmm. you get what you bought at the auction, plus you get the same credit. He keeps track of the thing so that you get double duty out of it. you're not having to pick.
Right.
When you earn it and you end up turning it in, now if you give it to someone else, that's not going to, if you got your name on it and everything and it's legitimately earned, say you don't want what we're auctioning, but she does and she doesn't have anything, and so you give her one of your purse dollars and then she uses it to bid. It's got your name on it. She can buy stuff with it, but you're going to get the participation credits. That's part of the reason you put your name on it. You earn that.
So, if you will, you know, pay her for that nice question.
Oh, but did I totally leave you out, Laura? I'll be right back.
When will we be credited for the online
Whenever he gets to it. Whenever he gets around to it. It's a bit of a challenge because if an auction comes up before he pays you but you've already earned it, then it's like, it gets a little bit hinky. So we try to have him pay you before we have an auction. Yes, sir. He's putting it away. He's going, I don't know if I can come up with something, but I am going to count this. I'll count them all.
Where do you know your ties? Most interesting time of
This tie came in 1996, January, from Ross. From Ross. It was just there, and I liked it, and I bought it. We were buying a booth. Singing session, and they don't like karaoke.
Right.
That's why they're not here. Is they heard that I was going to do karaoke today.
Why do you have all those objects on the table?
Oh, how come it took this long for someone to ask? Man. Well, I'm ready for you. There's another object that I'm going to put up there. The things that are up there are concrete visual images of things we're teaching here. Because some people are visual or more spatial in how they learn best. It's overblown, for you educational major types. Who's an education major? You maybe have had educational psych. The whole learning styles thing has been kind of, more serious research has thrown water on that sort of backyard school psychology stuff. But it is still true that people have preferred ways that they prefer to remember things and anchor things. And some people like to touch things. That, you know, if you want to mess with stuff, that's fine. Don't break it, but you can touch it and play with it, whatever. And you can see, and it creates parables. That's out of respect for the fact that different people learn different ways, and all of us can use multimodal experiences for memory. Do you remember we talked about the fact that it was a problem for a couple schools of thought in the early Socratic thinkers? The folk that believed that things were moving and other people believed that motion was all an illusion. Remember that? That one person, Heraclitus, however you want to pronounce it, is the one that said, you can't step in the same river twice. So everything has its identity in terms of its dynamics. And it, even reality, existence itself, is just motion. And that kind of turns out to be what we found from physics in a way. In a way. But then you have the other school of thought that says, no, motion is just an illusion. And one reason that motion is just an illusion is illustrated by this. You know what this is, right? This is one of those puzzles you're supposed to put the numbers in the right order by sliding the tiles around and you got one empty tile. I want you to pretend that instead of having 15 tiles, that there were 16 tiles. Okay? I want you to pretend that there were 16 tiles. There's 4x4 possible positions for the tiles. So if there were 16 tiles, how would we get it to move around? Okay, well, it would be stuck. So you have a whole school of pre-Socratic thinking that says, wait a minute, nothing is not a thing that exists. There's no such thing as nothing, because there's no thing. If it was a thing, then it could exist, and only things exist. There's no existence of not things. So that's even true of space, if it's a real thing. There can't be nothing there. Something has to be there. And if something is there, everywhere, then there's nowhere to move something else. What do you do? On your mark, get set. No, it doesn't work that way, because it'd have to move out of the way in order for something else to move in, and it doesn't. So that's why they said it's an absurdity to say that there's actually really motion at all. So remember I said that we've kind of shown by talking to you about the fact that matter itself is just made up of energy, and energy is like, you know, remember the slinky illustration? That's why we have the slinky. Did we do a slinky illustration? Yes. And this is here so you'll remember that slinky illustration. You know the difference between the metal that the slinky is made out of, the slinky itself, and the wave that goes back and forth. But it turns out that the slinky itself, the metal, is actually only made of wave. That's all it is. We know that. If we cut it into small enough pieces to find out what the heck it's made out of, we find it's made out of wave. But a wave isn't a thing. It's a happening. It's something that happens to things, or things do, right? It's like taking a whole bunch of verbs and adding them up and finally getting like a concrete noun out of them. Like running or spitting or looking. We take enough of those and put them together and we get something like a french fry, you know, or we get a little little iron filing or something. We don't. How could you have a wave add up to a thing that should have waves go through it, or that should form waves? So it turns out that then a few lectures later, we pointed out that actually everything is an illusion. There's no way to really draw the line and prove that absolutely anything that you're experiencing is not an illusion. The scientific method, the whole empirical method where you use your senses to get data about changes in the outer environment and all of that, has to go through the movie screen in your head, and it gets jerked up on the way. Plus, you and I can't even establish honestly that we're not dreaming right now. We don't have any way to prove we're not dreaming. The whole thing we demonstrated is an illusion. So if everything we could, if our whole reality is like a video game illusion matrix, then motion and everything else is an illusion. So then both of those pre-Socratic schools of thought have been legitimated already in our lectures. Did you follow that? So here's the slinky. And here is the tile puzzle. And if you remember, we did some things with these other things, too. And we talked about all these things. Like, there's a card. And I talked about if you take a microscope and you look at some printed material, you can see that it's actually not a complete, continuous, pretty picture. It's actually some little tiny dots and mostly white space, like reality. So you can use that microscope to experience that if you've never done that. You could probably even just use a magnifying glass, and you can see that stuff that comes even from a high-quality color laser printer, it's still just, there's more space than there is color if you look closely enough. Okay? So that's a very good question. Oh, yes. There are a few people that are important enough that I'd like us to kind of look at them biographically and give you a chance to shut me up and for you to come up here. It's not karaoke. You don't have to have a track on your karaoke box or anything. You don't even have to use a microphone. But just, you know, maybe 5 minutes to tell us about a number of people. And so I would like you to, can you write these down too? And then send me an email. I want you to, when you speak up for it, I want you to go to him, because we might go faster than he can write and get your business. Go to him and tell him your name and the character that you're doing the bio of, okay? Because I got to be able to keep track, and I'll never be able to keep track if he doesn't do the accounting for me. Okay? So I'd like somebody to do a presentation of about 5 minutes on each one of these people that we list. And I will pay you, well, it's more than you're used to getting. I will curse dollar you more than this is when the most curse dollars come out at one time. Like, it's not just one or two curse dollars. Okay. If it's crap, it might be. But if you do even a halfway decent a job that doesn't embarrass us both, then it's going to be pretty generous. Okay? And no, please don't just take your iPad or your laptop and go, oh, is that today? Okay. Heraclitus. And then read right down the Wikipedia. I mean, no. Put something together and we can read the wiki thing, but boil it down for us a little bit. Okay? Tell us something interesting that you Google and you actually found something that, even from somewhere other than Wikipedia. Like, I got links in here, and that you can go to the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy or that sort of thing.
We're doing it right now?
Today. Oh, no, it'll be days away from now. Oh. Now you'll have time. You don't have to just jump up.
Yeah.
You don't have to just jump up. Okay? So I want to give you a chance to do some of these, because some of you, it's easier for you to get up and do that than to, you know, sort of be in passive mode or get your hand up fast enough or find questions or whatever. It's just some of you like to be able to do this, and I want to give you the chance. You teachers and preacher types and orators and future presidents and all of that. Okay? First of all, let's do Thales. You got Thales. Go tell them all about it. And Anaximander, and Anaximenes, there, and let's see. Which one? Oh, let's knock these out. We know we need these. Socrates, you, Plato. And Aristotle. Make sure I don't want to get too many of them, but I do want to do some business with them because you'll never hear of them again as long as you live. we won't run into them. Parmenides. Parmenides. Make sure he knows. And Pythagoras.
I think I should just throw it in.
Descartes. You know what's special about Descartes?
I will.
Well, this won't be interesting for the report. It's just between the two. That's who I got when I took this class in 1982. There's a lot writing on you. I want to hear something about the community of life.
Okay.
I want to hear where it is in the brain. Just super. Oh, you already know. Tell me where it is. I mean, in the
front of the
brain.
I'll remember it.
Okay, everyone stands down. Zeno, what was it?
Wait, how do you
say that? Zeno of Aaliyah. Yes. There's more than one Zeno, but it's Zeno of Aaliyah. Okay, that's the one who's related to the picture on the book you have to start reading. That you're going to start reading up in the future. The whole course someone that we're not even going to get to, but I'm kind of, some people I'm hoping we get to. So really, if we don't do these, we'd be stupid. How about okay, George Barkley, it's actually spelled like Berkeley. Okay, and by the way, they spell it wrong even though they named the university. So George Berkeley. David Hume.
That's true.
Thomas Reed. Thomas Reed. R-E-I-D, Thomas Reed. Kant.
I just can't.
Can't.
What about Sartre?
Should we do Sartre?
Yeah.
Sartre. Oh, I got a dangerous one. Mr. Dangerous. You up to this one? You sure?
Yes. Wait, what did he
say? Steady. You have a question?
The God is not there is no God, or God is not.
Good one.
Yeah, they gotta present. They gotta get up. They don't get someone else to do it. They don't just hand in a paper and ask me to read it. They get up and do a report. Only these people does the research. But you want to play too? Oh, you asked a question. Oh man, let's see. Oh shoot, we didn't do Hegel yet.
What's his name?
Hegel.
Hegel?
Hegel. H-E-G-E-L. Or.
I think he did my work.
I usually don't draw too much from it, but sometimes stuff comes up.
in their presentations. So it's testimonials. You want to take notes just like I would. What was their main contribution? Were they an opponent of anyone else that's prominent? Now, when it comes to Socrates and Plato and Aristotle, the main contribution is just, I mean, we don't have that long. This whole class could just be about one of them, and we wouldn't scratch the surface, and we couldn't even get through more than one or two of their points if we really went deep. So you have to really, really come up with something to characterize somebody like Socrates or Plato or Aristotle. Who's got Plato? Plato. You know, there's a lot of cool stuff about Plato, and I'm going to say a lot of stuff about him, and you're going to say a lot of stuff, and we might repeat each other and everything. But in Plato's case, look at his relationship a little bit with Socrates. Some of the wilder theories, and some of the ones that if you read them, you kind of get the notion. Plato was gay. And Plato isn't his name. Plato's his nickname. It comes from the Greek platon, like a plateau, a table. Because we believe that he had enormous broad shoulders. He was such a big dude that they called him table. You know, like a football player you call refrigerator. Well, it's like his shoulders were like a big banquet table. So, and it looks like he had the hots for Socrates. He's not the only person that did. Alcibiades wasn't gay like Plato. Plato was gay like he didn't have any, what? Plato was gay like he didn't want women. He didn't desire women. But sort of the intelligentsia was like the drink and talk about philosophy type. They were bi, sort of socially bi. Like the upper class Athenians were bisexual, and they thought kind of, even though they were heterosexual, it was kind of like, well, that's for making babies, but they thought men were more handsome than women were beautiful. They go to the gym. You know what gym, G-Y-M, in Hindi. You know what gymnos means in Greek? Like for the gymnasium. We have a gym here on campus. It comes from the word gymnos. Who's a biology major? What's a gymnos for? Gymnos means naked. Gym. When you went to the gym, it was for lifting weights and posing nude. That's what it was for. They were making sculpture out of the human body instead of out of marble because they were into that and bathhouses and everything. This is how Athens was, but Plato was not like, goes both ways, one socially, one for reproduction. Plato, he did not have a desire for women. However, he was a feminist. He believed that women should be able to rule as long as they received education. He was critical of the fact that women, it wasn't decided whether to give a high-class education to a woman based on her gender, if she was up to it with her natural intellectual gifts, then she ought to be educated and be given a chance to be, you know, emperor or president or whatever, or on the Senate or whatever. He didn't believe it was okay to have a difference there. And he believed that they should be able to have property and everything, full on, like a man, as long as they can handle the responsibility. Now, Aristotle, Plato's student, he wasn't big on the traditional family structure. In his Republic, he writes this, what he considers a utopia, a sort of idealized society. He describes it in great depth, or I should say, he has Socrates do it as a character. But we don't really know how much of that Socrates said, how much Plato embellished, or just put in Socrates' mouth as a character.
But he didn't have traditional marriage going on. It was sort of like, sort of industrialized, sort of made a community social effort out of the whole thing. And you would have breeders, and he had intentional breeding going on and eugenics and that sort of thing. Very, very, that part was very Hitler-esque. And he even said, when babies were born, it was like, well, that one didn't come out so well. He says, they should just be taken out and exposed. He meant just left out for the wild animals in the cold, just infanticide. Now, Aristotle, who was a heterosexual, and he definitely didn't have a crush on his teacher like Plato had for Socrates. I started to say, Socrates wasn't having it. Socrates was not, he wouldn't participate in the sort of social bisexuality thing, guy on guy. Socrates was criticized because he had a strong wife that he respected her opinion. He'd argue with her, like with the man, and back and forth, and then a lot of times she'd win the argument, and they thought he was henpecked, and that he should take a strong hand with her, and he thought that was wrong. And he really cared for her. He really liked his wife, and that was enough for him, and he kept it at home. There's one passage where they had this symposium. Now, we hold theological symposiums. You know, we have the Adventist theological symposiums. A symposium is a word for a drinking party where you talk a bunch of crap philosophy after your three sheets to the wind. And they had a symposium, and they were drinking, and then people were pairing off to go home with one another. And then in recording it says, and Socrates, it says how everyone paired off with somebody, but then Socrates went home by himself. And Alcibiades once, who lusted after Socrates, said, what do you have to do to get Socrates to engage with you in the more important matter of these carnal pleasures? So Socrates wasn't having it, at least from what came down to us. Yes?
Is it true that Socrates loved somebody else?
I think he loved his wife. I mean, it may be true. There's a little bit of writing that one of his neighbors talks about him with, and he seduced people. He seduced people really frequently, but not sexually. He seduced them intellectually. They would be like lusting after what they were curious about with philosophy, with him supposedly. Now, did he have a, did he have a crush on somebody else? Now this is kind of a sensitive thing to say to anybody, but when you get married and you've been married for 10 years, this may come as a shock, but you will meet people that are like chemically attractive to you. They just be like, routinely, people just do. And that causes families to go in the ditch. Because people think when they get infatuated with somebody, even though they've got a workable relationship with their spouse, they think that this is magic and God has now brought them their true soulmate, and they even get addicted to these serial infatuations. But almost everybody here, if you enter a monogamous relationship, you will at times meet somebody that is extremely matched with you. Genetically, probably. You probably, pheromonally, your supercomputer in your organism goes, wow, that is a eugenics thing, when you receive pheromones from the person. And their temperament, if you work with them or whatever, may just match up. The psychologist Carl Jung, upon whose work the Myers-Briggs temperament analysis paradigm is based, said that there were four continua that the human psyche or personality could be from here to here on. You've probably heard people say things like, I'm an INTP, or I'm an ENTJ. Those letters come from the Myers-Briggs temperament inventory. And in terms of those four letters, you do one continuum, the other continuum, the other continuum, the other continuum. You establish what your letters are. To a person, you find somebody who on one of them is the same as you, and it's a specific one, not just any old one, but on one of them, they're the same. And then on the other three, they're the opposite. And you will be Twitter-pitting with that person when you meet them, period. It'll just be lock and key, and you're going, shoot, I thought I was a faithful spouse or fiance or whatever. So it may be that Socrates had something like that, but it appears that right to his deathbed, he still had concern for his wife and kids, and that was a priority at least. Not as much a priority, however, as maintaining his principles, his philosophical principles. Yes. There's probably some literary paleontology there. Read him and see. Read him and see, okay? You'll be able to tell. If you know...
So he had a relationship with another guy?
He wanted a relationship with
another
guy. It was unrequited. Because I think it was Socrates. I think he really loved Socrates in every way. You know? That was his hero, and the world absolutely revolved around Socrates to him, more than just a mentor. He loved him in every way.
On this site we're looking at, it says that Socrates married his wife because he loved her spirit, like a personality. But he like secretly loved another person and said it was a man. Do you know if that happened to be Plato?
I doubt it. There's quite a bit of indication that several people were commenting that it was too bad he wasn't willing to go that way. You know, it could be. It's how many, every line of it could be nonsense. Every line of something thousands of years old could be nonsense. But read Plato's actual writings and see what you think. I'll just say that. Read it and read the narratives and just see what you come up with. And then actually when you're reading it, same thing as when you're reading the stories in Scripture. Whatever it says in the narrative, make it be real humans as you're picturing it. Don't let it be storybook characters. Go, what would actually happen with real people whenever you're reading historic stuff like that? Or even a newspaper article about somebody that's still alive but you don't know. It has to have actually happened with real people or it didn't happen. They're not movie characters. They were, you know what I'm saying? So read it and see what you get. I didn't believe when I was a college student and I heard that Plato was gay. I said, oh, that's not true. I didn't think so. I thought, what a bunch of baloney. Everybody's making stuff up. And then I read for a few years and I said, oh, man. Okay. Sorry by me. I was silly. I don't know why I resisted the idea when I heard it from someone who knew. That guy then knows more than, he knew more then than I know now. He knew a lot.
For what reasons did Aristotle not like Plato, like Plato like Socrates?
Well, he disagreed with him fundamentally on a lot of things. He didn't get into this. You know, when you hear me talk, I'm talking about this bigger reality in another dimension. Things that are more real than just, you know, the virtual stuff here. Plato and Socrates, they agree with that. They totally, things in reality were not in the physical world. I mean, they're real here, but they're less real than, like, we're stick figures to somebody in five dimensions, kind of more, way more real. And to them, the things of the mind were the real things, not desks and chairs and toenails. Aristotle was not that kind of guy. Aristotle was a guy that says, yeah, okay, whatever, but all I know is I can see this, I can experience this, and you can speculate on all that crap all you want. But he was a scientist kind of a guy. He collected specimens. He was studying nature by using his eyes and writing things down and taking measurements and things like that. One of his pupils, the son of the Macedonian king, right, of King Philip, was Alexander. And Aristotle was the teacher of Philip's son, Alexander the Great. And as the narrative comes to us, everywhere that Alexander the Great went, conquering the known world, he would collect specimens, geology things, fossils, pieces of feathers, pine cones, plant specimens, creatures, skeletons, whatever, and he would send messenger to deliver all this to his beloved teacher. He collected things from all over the world for Aristotle's private museum and study. Aristotle didn't accept some of the most important things that Plato stood for in Plato's mind. And when it came time for Plato to hand the school over, even though Aristotle had been studying with him and was his star pupil, I mean, he was clearly the main guy under the director of the academy. But he didn't give it to him. He gave it to a cousin or nephew, some no-name guy whose works we don't even care about. So Aristotle was sort of like, I'm out. And he went and formed his own school at that point. He disagreed with Plato's notion on a lot of things in the Republic. He was a proponent of the traditional family. He believed that women should be subservient and should not be educated. Believed that everybody should, like, you know, sort of the traditionalist kind of a guy. That's a short little intro to it, but do you get the gist? Does that help at all? Okay.
So just so we you said that Plato was like had a lot of like writing that he like loved a man. What about in the biblical text?
It's more subtle than that.
It is.
Yeah, it's more subtle.
Like in the Bible, like one of the Bible says like Jonathan became one in spirit with David and he loved him as himself. And it's the same thing as like Corinthians and it says when you come into marriage you become one with your spouse. So like is that the same thing?
I don't think that David was homosexual. Might have been, but I think it was just that they were just very close. They just were very close. They were Semitic. And the relationship between two men, even today, in Semitic people groups, there are Arabs, and some of you may be Arab. I don't know if anyone here is of Arab extract. But in several Arab cultures today, men could greet each other and kiss on the lips and then walk holding hands, go down the street and hold hands, just going along like a couple would. But they're not gay. They're militantly heterosexual in many cases. So I doubt that David was a horn dog of a hetero. I mean, he could have been bi, but I don't think so. Did you get at it?
What you did for Plato, like how you just focused on like sexuality or whatever, you like when you gave your speech right now, what is it okay if we focus like that for when we give presentations? Like, can we
if
focus
you
want to
get
on
a
one
theme?
Yeah, just as opposed to like a general overview.
Sure.
Also, you forgot to pay her.
Did I?
Never mind, scratch that.
Oh, don't slow down, though. You keep it up. It doesn't cost anything to do that.
Trying to help you now.
That's a good question. That's a really good question. Why is it... it seems so hard for us to believe like that, right? Probably because we have all of us, and this includes even modern gay people. When you listen to modern gay people's rhetoric, you still, it's not completely unloaded. You can listen and you can go, well, why would you even say that? Why are you even accepting that much from the culture? It happens all the time. It's an issue right now. I hope we're not set back culturally by the political climate. I hope, you know, we don't lose ground in terms of everybody who has characteristics that are not the majority on whatever continuum. I hope we're kind of in a time now, and it scares me that when people are saying, I'm so sick of being PC, PC this and PC that, when what it really means is stop hurting everybody that isn't just generic, the run of the mill. You know, just stop being a bully. Stop making it so that people have to hurt and be marginalized or picked on or turned into the Omega Wolf. If we had that nailed down and it was just it meant nothing to us, it was just very matter of fact, that issue would be cared for, but there would be another one to just step right into its place. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we're wasting ink even giving someone a chance to talk such nonsense about one religion over another in our media right now. I'm embarrassed. It's like I step back 50 years, you know? There's something in us that will not let go of this in-group, out-group thing, and our mind, at the deepest level, continues to make categories, to draw circles. When you have your midterm, one thing that will be on the midterm for extra credit will be that I want you to, in word for word, and I'll post a word for word version of it because I'll probably butcher it in my memory now. I'll put the actual one, but Edwin Markham wrote a poem that I think embodies what it is that we do, like we draw a circle and then see if somebody's in it or out it. And the poem is just called, the title of the poem is Outwitted. And it just goes something like this. He made a circle that drew me out. Heretic, rebel, a thing to flout. But love and I had the wit to win. We made a circle that drew him in. That will be on the midterm and on the final. But it'll be an extra credit point. You won't lose anything if you don't know it. We have some things that we hold a special place for, and our sexuality is one of those things, at least in this culture. Now, there's cultures where that's not a big deal. There's cultures today, and some of them have a multiple century continuity in which if they found that a man or a woman was anything other than garden variety heterosexual, then they would immediately suspect maybe they were a shaman. Or they needed to be a spiritual leader or something. They were a special gift from the gods. So they were making a distinction, but it just went the other way. In our culture, though, we're so obsessed with our sexuality. You know, in ancient Hebrew cultures and others, they weren't allowed to utter the most holy name of their deity. You know, the tetragrammaton in Hebrew that we add vowels to pronounce Yahweh. the Jews wouldn't say it. They wouldn't even write the vowels. They said it didn't have vowels, lest somebody pronounce it. What is it that for the last, say, probably 75 years in the United States, what's the biggest language no-no? What can you say that's the most obscene, the most, you just don't say it or you just fire it on the spot? You know what the word is, and it is something that inarguably refers to that thing that we put on our deification pedestal. We promote our sexuality ahead of everything. Ahead of everything in our culture. Fortunately, we're gaining, at least some words are gaining some ground that are for a better reason. To not hurt people's feelings because certain words have become charged with racial hatred. So maybe that's a little progress that we put that on our no-no list ahead of an F. Because it's an automatic brain function. It's neurology. It's not just culture. Every conscious being that has senses that are kicking in, they're making categories and they're doing these sort of close fit things because that's actually the data processing model. That's the algorithm for how we do our automatic decisions to decide, not consciously but limbically, how we're going to feel in response to our environment. And many, many of the stereotypes that we have, they've given us some sort of payday. It may be a superstition, you know, like pigeons who become superstitious when there was a malfunctioning Skinner box back in the day. They were punishing pigeons by electrifying the mesh in the floor of their cage when they got a response they didn't want, because they're testing the difference between reward and punishment. And somebody had these pigeons actually still in the cage, went home for the weekend, and the cage was malfunctioning, and it was giving these random shocks on the floor onto their pigeons' feet all weekend. So when they come back, here's multiple pigeons that have had their cage thing, the circuit was malfunctioning, and they've developed actual superstitions and then been convinced by the number of times that they tried. One of them was like raising one leg, putting his head this way, and hopping around in circles like this. He developed a religious ritual that he somehow believed got rewarded by accidentally, it stopped shocking him when he did it, so then he couldn't let go of that. So we've had some of those kinds of things. And they're self-fulfilling prophecies. You alienate people and then they act like aliens. Funny thing.
I think part of it too is that like movies or stories or historical figures, we like to see ourselves in them. So like if we're not gay, there's a people like you don't want to see something else. Like I took a film class and I found out that like, there were a lot of undercurrents of like homosexuality, or like they just didn't mention it in the movie even though the plot was about it.
Uh-huh.
And I got like
And even if you had liked him, when they say it in a way that they mean to be bothering you by saying it, you would still wish they hadn't done it.
Yeah, so like we like to see ourselves making people, so if it's not what we would want to identify with.
Imagine what it would be like then to be homosexual and have like 95% of all of the stories you've ever read and all the movies you've ever seen with a protagonist that you could never identify with. Now imagine that the way you felt when you were having this anomalous media experience was the way it was for you to watch a movie or read a play or anything for your whole life. That would be a rugged deal, wouldn't it? That's kind of what I think it probably is like to be somebody who's just, whatever characteristic is under discussion, isn't in the majority, and we make a big deal out of it.
Well, it's just interesting because I was surprised it felt that way. So, like, you don't realize even that you have that mindset.
Because it's underneath. It's not on purpose. It's in the part of you that you don't have access to, the part of you that makes your heart beat. It's something that's in your amygdala. You can't directly control your amygdala. It's not something that's here. It's not in your frontal cortex where you make rational decisions and you plan and scheme and decide what to do. That's your override thing. It's something that comes up automatically and seems like God's reality to you. So, Crystal, that was pay dirt. There was gristle and muscle, and we could get our teeth into that one. There could be a major. There is. Not here, but I mean, there's people who have undergraduate, graduate, and doctoral degrees in gender issues or in queer studies or any of those things. Can you imagine if you knew that much and had thought that much, what it would be like to reconsider the issues? That would be powerful. Excellent. Excellent. Any other questions? Yes, sir. Well, you know, there is a philosophy of empathy. There, philosophy considers empathy, definitely. Empathy is a brain function. You empathize with somebody when your mirror neurons are functioning the way that they do in most people. There are some people who don't experience very much empathy, or they're not capable, apparently, of what we call empathy. They can do things to people or see things happen, and it doesn't activate their mirror neurons. The mirror neurons, they cause us to look at the person and consider what they've got going on, and then in the parietal lobe, where we form our sense of self, in the special part of the parietal lobe where we form this, hey, this is me, I recognize this as me, or hey, it's the part that keeps us from eating our own leg, even though if we're not vegetarian, we might eat a leg of lamb. Or creatures, like a dog, would consider eating another creature's leg, even another dog's leg. They're not going to eat their own leg. Because they know in the parietal lobe says all that stuff in your homunculus, your sensory motor cortex, that's you, dude. Don't eat it. Don't screw with it. Okay, that's you. So we blend our concept of the other person with self so that there's less distinction. We bring them inside of ourself in terms of our concept. And then that allows us, whatever is happening to them, we can experience that like if somebody said, okay, you're gonna now have your turn. Now, if you see someone getting the daylights beat out of them and they're handcuffed, and then someone says next, and the cop pushes you, and you have an idea in your imagination of what's about to happen to you. You start to hurt and panic and have cortisol release and all of that, and you constrict your blood vessels and your blood goes to the core, and you have a sympathetic nervous system activation. And that happens when you see somebody else, just like it was you. So that's kind of what empathy is. Does that have a philosophical thing to it? Absolutely. In fact, in non-Western cultures, philosophy and religion and spirituality and psychology and physics are all one thing run together more. And so it would be seen, for instance, by a traditional Indian thinker or by a Hindu, especially in India, that in truth, everything is all just one, and that they would believe in their philosophy that the distinction that says, hey, this is me, that's him, that's her, that's God, that's, you know, that's, this isn't me, this is me. They would think that that's kind of it's a delusion, and our job, spiritually and philosophically and psychologically, our task, developmentally, is to grow up and realize that that's nonsense, that everything is just one thing. Does that make sense? Oh, seriously? What's the matter with me? Wow.
Okay, so kind of to piggyback on that question, do you know of any research or like actual data supporting any difference between how many neurons there are in men versus women?
Yeah, I have seen some. I don't know what the ratio is, but I have seen some research about that. Additionally, and almost inseparably for the function of empathy, would be the location and type of oxytocin receptors in the brain. Not mammary, but in the brain. And those are actually really differently placed. They're not, I mean, there's like, wow, here's a predominance of them in men, and here's a predominance in women of these receptor sites for oxytocin. Oxytocin being the peptide that's been called the love hormone, the bonding hormone. It's the one that causes uterine contractions and the lactation letdown reflex. And it's what lets lactation occur. It's also what allows sort of imprinting kind of bonding. It's what allows you to bond with someone when you are in love with them. When you have an experience together that's intense and you bond with them, male or female, you know, you get this pro-social thing with them. Hey, we've been in foxhole together, you know, and had the mortars flying and saw this guy die and everything. Oxytocin cements your relationship with one another. Also, semen contains a tremendous amount of oxytocin. So, intercourse can cause this surge in donated oxytocin. And in heterosexual coitus, that is partly why women want to sustain closeness, and men are going, all right, already. Because the man just lost oxytocin, and the woman gained it. Because it absorbs. Does that make sense? So I'll have to look. Would you send me an email specifically asking? It'll be an easy matter for me to ascertain whether or not that's been established. I'd be happy to do it for you. Send me an email with that. I paid you, right? Okay. Next. Good enough. Okay. Quiz. We're going to take about 10 minutes for the quiz, okay? From the time you get it.